exam Wednesday. Yes, sorry, the early time is 7:20. We will start again. Sorry about that. Bring your copy if you need to. What's it going to be on? We will review today. Well, starting with essentially with the Cauchy-Riemann equations, you were tested a little bit on the Cauchy-Riemann equations on the first exam. Might test you again on the Cauchy-Riemann equations on the second exam, maybe focusing on the polar form. That'd be good to review. It also might be good to review the multivariable calculus chain rule and how to think about interpreting that. If we have time, we'll talk about that today. After the Cauchy-Riemann equations came harmonic functions, steady-state temperature distributions. Then we got into elementary functions, polynomials, rational functions, trig functions, exponential functions, and their multi-value inverses, logarithms, power functions, hyperbolic functions, and yeah, the inverses, inverse sine, inverse cosine, inverse tangent. A little bit more about harmonic functions and solving Laplace's equation, and then the fundamentals in chapter 4 about integration. Alright, so that's a real quick summary of the topics. Let's go back to the example that we were looking at last time with z squared. Let me remind you what the situation was. So the function that we were integrating was z squared. And we were integrating it over a piece of a parabola, parameterized this way. It's an oriented curve. It's got an orientation as t increases. You trace out that curve in that direction right there, starting at the origin, ending at the point 2 plus 4i when t was 2. Okay. Let's remind ourselves how to calculate this now. We'll have the computer do the calculations for us. I'll put it right here. You can use the parameterization as a complex number, a complex quantity, I should say. So you could define z of t exactly this way to be t plus I times t squared. You can define f of z to be z squared. And then you can do the integral purely in terms of complex quantities like this. Let's see where these are going. So, do you remember what that means? We're going to ultimately integrate from 0 to 2, right? Because that's the limit on t. The limit's on t. What goes in the integrand? What goes inside here? Do you remember? Talking purely in terms of complex quantities here, which is really the simplest thing we can do. Remember? Symbolically, we're writing the integral in this way. But that doesn't tell you how to calculate it. How do you use the parameterization? Take the z of t and do what? Do two things with it. Anybody remember? Plug it into f. That's one thing you do. What else? Yeah, multiply it times the derivative. And that's the thing that you integrate from 0 to 2. And there's the answer. Right. That was the same thing we got when we did 5 camp last run. Negative 88 over 3 minus 16 over 3i. We did that last Friday. Hopefully you wrote it down. If you didn't write it down, you can go back and watch the video. We went through through the details of how that calculation came out. But that's not the only way we can do it. Another way we can do it is we can relate it to line integrals from multivariable calculus. We can think in terms of real imaginary parts. We can try to expand this complex quantity into a real part plus I times an imaginary part. Okay, I'm going to suppress the z's. I'm also going to suppress any x's and y's here, just to go faster. U and v do depend on x and y. That's the real and imaginary parts of f of z. How about dz? Does it have real and imaginary parts too? Yeah. Dx and dy. Multiply that out. Are you really doing a multiplication when you do that? Not really. I mean, we're talking infinitesimal quantities here. Can we really multiply it? Not really, according to our standard real number system, but it doesn't hurt to pretend, as we've done many times. What's the real part going to be? First times first is real, u dx. Last times last, iv times iuy is real, but you get an I squared, so you get a minus sign. There's the real part. Plus I times the imaginary part. It's going to come from outside and inside products. U, I, U, I, and V, V, I, dx. Factor the I out. Do the term with the dx first. That would come from the inside product. V, dx, plus U, dy. So we can do each of those real line integrals and combine them in this way, that plus I times that one. And both of these real line integrals can also be thought of in terms of dot products. Of vector fields. You can think of the first one this way, where this vector here is the vector of differentials, dx and dy, plus I times the line integral of this vector field, vu, like that. Just alternative notation for the same thing. The vector field dot product notation can help us understand what it means, though we are going to postpone meaning until Friday. If you read your multivariable calculus book a little bit over the weekend, as I told you you should do, you would have been hopefully reviewing stuff about work done by a force, and maybe the flux of a fluid across a membrane, a flux integral, which I'm not really talking about flux integrals here, I'm talking about ordinary line integrals, which give you work done by forces, thinking of those vector fields as being force fields. What's an example of a force field? Like a gravitational field or an electric field. You don't have to worry about that too much if you don't feel like you know the physics, but it does give it some meaning if you make an attempt to understand it at least. So we can calculate it this way too. Let's try it that way. But now we need to use a vector parameterization. An x of t and a y of t. We're still parameterizing the graph, essentially, of t squared, or you might say x squared. Z of t, the parameterization in terms of complex quantities, is t plus I times t squared. The real part is t, and the imaginary part is t squared. You can call those x and y, if you like. And then you can put these together in a vector, call it r of t, like this. Something we always were doing in multivariable calculus. The first month or month and a half of that course, we were doing this kind of thing all the time. Let's enter u and v as well. Let me use curvy braces inside these functions because I'm going to be plugging in vectors, lists into these things. The real part is x squared minus y squared. We are still talking about z squared here. And the imaginary part, as you, I hope you have memorized by now, as we've done it so much, is 2 times x times y. Alright, so the real part is supposed to be the line integral of, what was it again? You have to look over here. That vector field, u negative v. Okay, I guess. Let's do it this way. This should work. And when you do an ordinary line integral from multivariable calculus using a parametrization, you plug the parametrization into f, and you dot that with the velocity vector. It's not a complex multiplication, that's a dot product of vectors. In Mathematica, a dot product of vectors is done with a period. No star there, don't put a star. It's a dot product. So this should be what? Negative 88 over 3. Is it? Yay, it is. And then if I do the other one, I should get negative 16 thirds. Come on, copy. Do the other one, make this a b, make this a u. Just like we have over there. We should get negative 16 thirds. You should be able to do these by hand, which means you need to be able to simplify these things by hand. It's not too hard to do. You just need to plug in into this formula, for example, plug in x equals t and y equals t squared. Into this formula, again, plug in x equals t and y equals t squared. You also need to find the velocity vector, r of t. Zoom in on this, it's difficult to see. R of t is t squared. So r prime, the velocity vector for that parametric curve would be 1 comma 2t. That would be what r prime would be. And you need to remember how to take a dot product. You can expand out what these functions are as well if you're interested in seeing what they look like. For the second example, to get negative 16 thirds, you'd be integrating this thing. So it wouldn't be too hard. Just got to make sure you do the right thing. I thought I copied, just copied and pasted the other one.
You just pasted it into the title of the next section.
Did I? Whoops. And then we saw the best way to do it would be to use the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus. And yes, there is a version of the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus that does apply here. This function, f of z equals z squared, is analytic over the entire plane. More importantly, it's got an antiderivative. That's analytic over the whole plane. Function whose derivative is always equal to that, plus any constant c, but of course when you do definite integrals, you don't have to bother with the c. Integrating f of z over this oriented curve, this oriented contour, d and just do f of the terminal point, z sub t stands for terminal point, minus capital F of the initial point, z sub I stands for initial point. Terminal point is 2 plus 4i, initial point is 0, so we ultimately do 2 plus 4i cubed over 3, and we did see last time that that gives us the same thing, negative 88 minus 16 thirds i. Doing it by hand involves using the binomial theorem. We should be able to do that. We evidently this is true without bothering to use the parameterization at all. So, what would that imply? If we never bothered to use the parameterization at all, the parameterization must be irrelevant. And the path itself, the curve, must be irrelevant. All that matters is the starting point and the ending point. So the integral over some other contour from the origin to 2 plus 4i should give you the same answer. That's a pretty amazing thing. What would be the simplest thing to use? How about 2t plus 4t times I? That would be a parameterization that would start at the origin and end at the point 2 plus 4i. It would be a straight line instead of a curve. But since the fundamental theorem of calculus never refers to the parameterization, if we use the parameterization to do the integral, we should get the same thing. It would be a different integral, and you do need to be careful about the limits of integration. They're not going to be 0 to 2 in this case, they're going to be 0 to 1. Right? Because it would be up to the terminal point after 1 unit of time with this parameterization, with this curve and its parameterization. And yeah, you did the same thing. It would give you the same thing if we use, say, an arc of a circle. Circle to use. How about a circle centered at 1 plus 2i? Say that point is 1 plus 2i. What would the radius of that be? The radius would be what? Square root of 1 squared plus 2 squared. Square root of 5, it looks like, for this radius of the circle. Well, we have to figure out where it. What moment in time is at the origin. Let's just experiment a little bit. Square root of 5 times cosine t plus I times square root of 5 times sine t. That would be a parameterization such that when t is 0, you're at the rightmost point of the circle. I'd like to be at start of the origin. What moment in time is this going to equal 0? Oh, I got it. I gotta do a plus 1 here and a plus 2 with this one so that I'm centered at the right point. Sorry about that. More than one answer. Arctangent of 2 minus pi evidently would be one answer. And that would be the lower limit of the integral. Since arctangent of 2, what should arctangent of 2 be? Arctangent of 1 is pi over 4. somewhere between pi over 4 and pi over 2. Subtract pi from it. We're talking about this angle here, essentially. Seems about right. And the upper limit of the integral is when I'm up to 2 plus 4i, let's set this equal to 2 plus 4i, arctangent of 2 looks like it works. So amazingly, this should give the same answer too, though it might not write it in a very simple form. It doesn't. Oh, that's because I re-entered this, sorry. There we go. Same thing. That would be a lot harder integral to do, I imagine. How hard? Let's go ahead and see what this formula looks like. Yeah, I don't want to do that one by hand. Is it doable? Yeah, it is. You want to replace cos squared t with 1 half plus 1 half cos 2t. Remember that from Multa? It's an identity. Cos squared t is 1 half plus 1 half cos 2t. With cos cubed, you want to do a substitution. You want to write that as cos x times 1 minus sine squared x, and let w equal sine x as your substitution. That would actually be an easier one. Well, that would be easier to do if you didn't know the identity for that one. Yeah, it's doable, but I think if I forced myself to do it, it would take me, with all the complex numbers in there, it might take me 20 minutes, and I could easily make a mistake. But it is the same thing. Okay, so there is a fundamental theorem of calculus involved with this. What would the fundamental theorem of calculus imply if our curve had an initial point and ending point that was the same? Obviously, it should apply what? The integral's zero. Subtracting the same thing. If f of capital F of z is an antiderivative of little f of z over whatever domain you're talking about, and if this curve is inside that domain, this integral is going to be zero. The integral around this loop must be zero. So what I'm talking about here with in the context of examples is the theorem that some things are equivalent that you can find on page 176 in this box here. You got a domain, little f is assumed to be continuous, the following are equivalent. Little f has an antiderivative capital F over that domain. Every loop integral of little f vanishes. This is a loop. It comes back to where it starts. Assuming the loop is inside the domain. And the contour integrals themselves are independent of path. It doesn't matter how I get from the initial point to the ending point. As long as I stay in the domain, the integral is going to be the same. These same things came up in multivariable calculus, too. We were talking about conservative vector fields in multivariable calculus. Same themes, independence of path, integrals around closed curves that come back to where they start, being zero. There's an even more general fact that can be stated. related to that. It's called Cauchy's Theorem, Cauchy's Integral Theorem, to distinguish it from Cauchy's Theorem in algebraic structures. You should have seen Cauchy's Theorem in algebraic structures. This is Cauchy's Integral Theorem, also known as the Cauchy-Goursat Theorem. Cauchy evidently thought of it first. Cauchy lived early to mid-1800s. Goursat came along and made the theorem a bit more general. I'm used to hearing it called just Cauchy's Theorem, but I think Goursat should get some credit here, so I will actually make an endeavor to call it the Cauchy-Goursat Theorem, as some people do. Says the suppose f of z is analytic on a domain that's going to be a special kind of domain. On a what's called simply connected domain. Now I mentioned simply connected last Friday, and I said basically you can think of it as a domain with no holes in it. No points taken out, no individual points taken out, no sets of points taken out that form holes, if you took them out, at least. The technical definition of simply connected is a bit more technical. In section 4.4, the book approaches it two ways. There's this first half of section 4.4, and then there's the second half of 4.4. I suggested that you read it the second half, because that's what I was going to focus on today. One definition of simply connected is that you can take any loop and shrink it to a point without leaving the domain. That's not going to be possible in a domain with a hole in it. So you got a domain here with a hole in it. Every loop cannot be shrunk to a point without leaving the domain. Any loop that goes around the hole, in particular, cannot be shrunk to a point in a continuous way without leaving the domain. So this is not a simply connected domain. An alternative definition that the book gives in the second half of section 4.4 is that given any loop, the set that's inside the loop is a subset of the domain, which is not in that case. Suppose f of z is analytic on a simply connected domain, and that gamma is a closed contour, a loop inside the domain. Then the integral of f around the closed contour is zero. Okay, this was the statement of the Cauchy-Goursat theorem. And to prove it, I'm going to hint at the proof here in a minute. To prove it in the way that I'm going to hint at requires extra assumptions, extra hypotheses. It requires that you assume not only is f analytic, but that its derivative is continuous. And so if that's what you would need, you'd need stronger hypotheses to prove it that way. Then this would not be the statement of the theorem. I'd have to add the hypothesis that f prime be continuous. What Goursat did was that he came along and said, no, you don't need to assume f prime is continuous. This is still true. The proof is harder, but it's still true. that is even more amazing, you might say, because the proof that I'm about to outline right now relies on Green's theorem, so it's relying on a theorem for multivariable calculus, which makes the proof almost trivial if you accept Green's theorem. But no, you can do a harder proof with a more general theorem that doesn't require Green's theorem. What does Green's theorem say?
Got a new green marker here.
Oh, that's hard to see. Green's theorem. Can you see it back there again? Maybe zoom in. Can you guys see that well enough? I'll try to make it dark, as dark as I can. Assume you've got a vector field. Okay, this is not a complex analysis result. The book calls the vector field V, and there's a good reason for that. You're often going to think of it as a velocity vector field for a fluid. But I'm more used to calling it F. I think in multi I call it F1 and F2, but I'm going to call it P and Q like I've been doing recently here. Is a continuously differentiable vector field on some domain. What does continuously differentiable mean? I mean, you can somehow differentiate it continuously. No. What it means is the derivatives exist, the partial derivatives of P and Q, and are continuous functions. That's what continuously differentiable means. The partials exist and are continuous functions. Are you okay with me just saying that? The book mentions that too. And by domain here, I do mean actually an open set. And let's assume capital gamma is some closed contour, a loop, inside the domain with what's called a positive orientation. It is a positively oriented closed contour. I could call that a loop. Positive orientation means basically, well, in most pictures at least, that the curve is going counterclockwise. A little bit more technically, it means that as you traverse the curve in the positive direction, the set inside the closed curve, you were walking along the closed curve in the positive direction, would be to your left. That's still not real precise, but I think it's good enough to just say it in that physical way. If you were walking around this closed curve, the set inside the closed curve would be to your left. If you're walking in that direction. So yeah, then overall that's kind of a counterclockwise orientation, although sort of in parts you could be going clockwise, like right in there. Then what can you say? Then the line integral of F around this closed contour, and sometimes to emphasize the contour is closed, you'll see books put it like a little circle in there. That's not mandatory. And whenever I saw that in books, I was always confused. What is it? Why is there a little circle there? A little circle just means it's a closed contour. Sometimes you'll also even see a little arrow on the little circle indicating it's got a positive orientation. It's not mandatory that you put that there, though. But you can do this line integral by doing a double integral of what we call the scalar curl in multivariable calculus. Take this vector field, take its second component, and differentiate it with respect to the first variable, and then subtract the derivative of the first component with respect to the second variable. That's a double integral, so you have a an area element, dA there. What is the domain of integration? The domain of integration is the inside of gamma. Gamma and the inside of gamma. Our book sometimes calls it D prime. D prime is the region consisting of gamma and the inside of gamma. I'm not being real precise about what inside is. I'm looking at the picture here. What was the purpose of the Green's theorem? In multivariable calculus, there were two purposes. One was it helps you do Latin integrals sometimes. You can calculate it as a double integral, which might sound harder, but sometimes is actually easier, especially when you can't parameterize the oriented curve so easily. Second purpose was to help us understand what the scalar curl means, and it was related to little paddle wheels rotating and the fluid flow. Maybe go into that on Friday. Green's theorem makes the proof of the Cauchy-Goursat theorem, if you also assume f prime is continuous, fairly easy. I'm not going to write it out in sentences, but let's write a couple of an equation or two that help us see why it works. As we saw just what, half hour ago? As we saw a half hour ago, this is the same as the integral of u comma negative v dot ds plus I times the line integral of v comma u dot ds. Those are both line integrals that are real, and that we can apply Green's theorem to, assuming we've got gamma being a simple closed contour there, oriented positively. So what happens when you apply Green's theorem to these things? Here. Think about it, okay, you do a double integral of the second component, the derivative of the second component with respect to the first variable minus the derivative of the first component with respect to the second variable. Second component here is negative v. Differentiate that with respect to the first variable, x. Subtract the derivative of the first component with respect to the second variable. Do the same kind of thing here. The second component is u. Differentiate that with respect to the second variable. With respect to the first variable. Subtract the derivative of the first component with respect to the second variable. We're almost done. Basically, it's trivial from here if we also use what? What do you think? I am assuming f is analytic. That must be important. Cauchy-Riemann. Done. Using the subscript notation for those partials to go a little faster. This is the Cauchy-Riemann equations. You know, it's been a long time since we've talked about the Cauchy-Riemann equations, but they're so important, you don't want to forget them. We are assuming f is analytic, that's got to be important. And if we also assume f prime is continuous so that we can apply Green's theorem, that's where that assumption comes in, by the way. Assuming f prime is continuous, that's going to mean that the vector fields here are continuously differentiable. Their derivatives, their partial derivatives, are continuous. We can therefore apply Green's theorem right here. And say that these integrals must be zero because the integrands are identically zero. They're always zero. So again, that would prove Cauchy's theorem in the situation where you also assume f is not only analytic, but its derivative is a continuous function. But again, this is actually true even if you don't make that extra assumption. And amazingly, something else we're going to see in a week or two is that analyticity, which initially just implies differentiability in a neighborhood of a given point, is enough to imply that the function is actually infinitely differentiable. Not only do you have a first derivative, you have a second, third, infinite amount. Which doesn't always happen in the real case, for sure. It's a big difference between what happens with complex analysis versus real analysis. You can come up with functions that are, in real analysis, that are differentiable in the neighborhood of the point, but it's only first differentiable, not second. For example, if you let f of x equal, say, x squared if x is greater than or equal to 0, and negative x squared if x is less than 0, that's a differentiable function. And you can write down a piecewise formula for its derivative. And this is true even at x equals 0. F prime of 0 is 0. But f double prime of 0 does not exist. That kind of thing can't happen in complex analysis. Not only does f prime of 0 exist at equals 0, it's f prime does exist on a neighborhood of 0. It's more than just differentiability at a point, but we lost second differentiability at that point. It doesn't happen in complex analysis with analytic functions. I think it could happen with functions that are differentiable at just one point. But remember, analyticity means more than just differentiability at the point. It means differentiability in a neighborhood of the point. All right, let's review now. Don't have a ton of time, but we can do just a pretty quick reminder of some things that could be in the test. You should be able to do. So again, there's the Cauchy-Riemann equations. They were on the last test, you just needed to verify them in one example on the last test. You should certainly be able to use them for this test too. And you should know the polar form. And I mentioned how to interpret it. Really, ultimately, how to interpret the chain rule geometrically in a situation where you're using polar coordinates. For example, du dr, can be thought of as du dx times dx dr plus du dy times dy dr, where dx dr, thinking about the conversion equations, x equals r cos theta, y equals r sine theta, dx dr is cos theta, dydr is sine theta. So I can write this. And that can also be thought of as a dot product. Cos theta sine theta dotted with the vector du dx, du dy, which is really the gradient of u. And remembering what gradient vectors are and what they, how can they be interpreted geometrically, this can help you understand how to interpret UDR, how to guess its value. For example, if you've got some level curves, use 3 along here and 5 along here, and maybe you're at this point right here, the coordinate system, and maybe the origin's right there. And you're wondering, what's the rate of change of u in the radial direction? In that direction. Well, it's the dot product here. Actually, if this is a unit vector here, it is exactly this vector right here. If this is a unit vector, one unit one, it's that vector. And the gradient vector is going to point in this direction. So if you think about the geometric meaning of the dot product, that is the length of this, which is 1, times the length of that, the magnitude of that, times the cosine of the angle between them. You can, for example, say, since that angle is acute, the direction of the derivative has to be positive, and you can see what it is. It's definitely positive, just looking at the picture. You can also try to estimate the length of the gradient and estimate the cosine of the angle to help you estimate the this derivative if you wanted to. I mean, it would be an estimate. I only gave you a picture. It's something you should be able to do. Probably if I put this type of thing on the test, I mean, I've got a related complex analysis like the Cauchy-Riemann equations for one thing. The Cauchy-Riemann equations, this would be 1 over r times dv d theta, related to v in some way. I'd probably remind you of some things here, so you wouldn't have to like re-derive this from scratch. Next came the section about harmonic functions, so you should know what Laplace's equation is, and that harmonic functions satisfy Laplace's equation. Laplace's equation, and of course that the real and imaginary parts of an analytic function are harmonic. You should be able to verify that. It ultimately uses the Cauchy-Riemann equations to verify that, as well as the fact that mixed second-order partials are equal when you do them in the opposite order, assuming everything is continuous. That was called Clairaut's theorem for multi. And you should also know that given a harmonic function on some open connected set, some domain, it's going to be the real part of some analytic function. And you should be able to find the imaginary part by integrating. Using the Cauchy-Riemann equations, there's an example on page 80. We did do at least one example in class too. And I think we at least had one or two homework problems on that. Which, by the way, I'll remind you that I am making an attempt to at least put two or three problems that are pretty similar to homework problems on the test. So I will. I did do that on the first exam, and I'm planning on doing that for the second exam. Finding at least two, maybe three homework problems, and basically making those exam problems with slight modifications. And again, chapter 3 was about elementary functions, polynomials and rational functions. So you should be able to know facts about polynomials. You should be able to do long division and synthetic division. Polynomials. Synthetic division is only for when you're dividing by things of the form z minus a. Long division works even when you're dividing by quadratics, for example. And how to interpret the quotient and the remainder, and how to factor when you can, quadratic formula, all things you're pretty used to, but now they apply in the complex setting. There's the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus. Every non-constant polynomial with complex coefficients has at least one zero, which ends up implying it has at least n zeros when the degree of the polynomial is n, though you sometimes have to count multiplicity if it's a repeated zero. And then rational functions are ratios of polynomials, and where the denominator is zero, at least if you cancel any common factor, those become poles. There was that complicated formula for the coefficients in the partial fraction decomposition that I did assign a problem on. It's one of those where I said everybody should do this one. I wanted you to all do it once using the complicated formula at the bottom of page 106 involving derivatives, limits of derivatives. But I never talked about that formula in class. And it is difficult to use, I think, especially on a test, so it's not going to be on the test. But you should be able to do an ordinary partial fraction decomposition and solve for the coefficients in the numerators to help you to do partial fractions. The coefficients could be complex numbers now. But I'm not going to require you to be able to use this formula. Remember that thing was kind of nasty. Involving derivatives. It's a theoretical use, and it's of use when we're going to talk about residues. And actually, if you look on that old exam, I did ask the person to compute the students to compute the residue at a point. So you got a function. It's got a pole at, say, z equals, just to make something up, 2 plus 3i. Let's say it's a rational function. If you do a partial fraction decomposition, the coefficient for this term in the partial fraction decomposition, whatever number goes up here, I'll just call it capital A, that coefficient is called the residue of the function at that pole.
The residue of f at this pole, pole 2 plus 3i, is whatever capital A happens to be.
You do the partial fraction decomposition, and if there is a pole at 2 plus 3i, you're going to get, possibly at least, a term like this. You could also get a term where you have z minus 2 plus 3i squared in the denominator, too. That could happen. Although, according to our book's approach to partial fractions, yeah, that could happen. Whatever the coefficient of that is, call it b, that has nothing to do with the residue. It's always the term, the first power. Whatever the coefficient is up there, that's the residue at this point, at that pole. Residues are really important in chapter 6. They're going to help us do more complicated kinds of integrals. And residue theory actually, even though it doesn't sound beautiful, it is beautiful. Then you've got our other functions, exponentials, hyperbolic, trig, inverse functions, logarithms, inverse trig, inverse hyperbolic, multivalued functions, taking branches of multivalued functions, and the real and imaginary parts of those things being harmonic and helping you solve the Laplace equation in a certain special situation. And then integrals. Okay, so that's a real quick summary of the content. I think it is a lot of stuff. So put a good effort in, and we'll see you bright and early on Wednesday at 7:20. Thank you.